Hey there, everyone. I'm Nick Ravelis, the Geisel Director of Education and Outreach, but you can call me Dr. Nick. Let me take you back 850 years to England in the Middle Ages, the era of knights in shining armor, kings battling for supremacy over their people, and a time when the church was all-powerful throughout Europe. Authority in the church came from the Pope, who ruled the whole church from his base in Rome. It was widely believed by everyone that his authority came directly from God. So even kings had to pay him homage, and very rarely would they challenge the Pope on anything. The Pope had authority over all the priests and bishops in the world, as well as all of the churches, monasteries, universities, and convents that had been built in the church's name. It was a vast spiritual empire that at the same time had a lot of material assets, treasures in gold, silver, art, architectural landmarks. As you can imagine, kings in their individual kingdoms often had very differing views than those of their churchmen in their lands, and they would have to appeal to the Pope for judgment. King Henry II was ruler in England, and at the time his kingdom included parts of France as well. In fact, his official title in England was King of England and France, much to the annoyance of the actual King of France. Henry's kingdom was administered by his chancellor, one Thomas Becket. Thomas did everything the king wanted, always obeying his orders and doing his bidding. Thomas was a soldier, an athlete, a linguist, a scholar. He was also tall and handsome, and Henry liked him very much, relying on his advice in everything concerning the kingdom. In fact, he liked him so much that when the leader of the church in England, the Archbishop of Canterbury, died, Henry asked the Pope in Rome to lift Thomas to that high position. Now, mind you, Thomas wasn't even a priest at the time. So one day he's ordained a priest, the next day he's enthroned as Archbishop of Canterbury. It's pretty obvious by suggesting this move that the king wanted something. He wanted a friend in high places. He wanted someone he could trust and depend on, just in case he had a difference of opinion with the Pope in Rome. Someone to help tip the scales in his favor. But something very strange happened. Thomas became, virtually overnight, a serious man of the church. It was like he had a conversion, and no longer considered himself a worldly man, but a spiritual man. No longer a lord in the king's realm, but a representative of the Pope and the church. This was a very dangerous position for him to be in. And an opportunity for a clash of principles came very quickly after Thomas's acceptance of his new post. The king believed that when priests committed crimes, they should be judged in a civil court and sentenced like any ordinary citizen of England. The Pope disagreed. He felt that priests were under the jurisdiction only of the church. The church, in fact, had its own system of courts, and that's where priests and monks should have been judged. The king didn't think this was fair because the church courts tended to be more lenient than the courts of the state. But the Pope was firm on this, and Thomas, now Archbishop, supported the Pope and not his old friend, the king. This infuriated Henry II, and things went from bad to worse. The relationship between king and archbishop deteriorated so badly that Thomas left the country and stayed in France for 7 years before he felt it was safe to return. That's where the opera Murder in the Cathedral begins, with Thomas the Archbishop returning from his exile, fully aware that England was not a safe place for him to be, that the king would ultimately have his way, and that nothing and nobody would stand in his way. That proved to be all too true. At Christmas time in the year 1170, four knights in the king's household appeared at the cathedral in Canterbury and attacked Thomas during a church service, hacking him to death with their swords. This event shook Europe to its core. Within 2 years after the murder of Thomas Becket, he was made a saint by the Pope, and the king had to publicly acknowledge his involvement in the murder. He had to ask forgiveness of the Pope and the church. Even then, as now in many countries, and even here to a certain extent, friction between the church and the state did not ease up at all, and seemed to constantly be at odds. As you can tell from the story of the opera as it's taken from history, this is a very serious drama that deals with politics and ideas. It's not an opera that deals with emotions like so many other operas. The composer, Ildebrando Pizzetti, wrote the opera in 1958 in an attempt to make music and drama absolutely equal partners in the art of opera. Pizzetti believed that Italian opera, with its arias and ensembles written to show off the beauty of the human voice, had gone down the wrong path, that it had somehow become more about the singers and less about the drama. He wanted to correct this imbalance, so he chose stories to turn into operas that had more drama in them, stories from the ancient Greek days, for instance, and stories like the murder of Thomas Becket. So in the opera, Murder in the Cathedral, there are no arias like you'll find in other operas that we're doing this season. But there's lots of lyrical writing, lots of beautiful music that matches the ideas, the story, and the drama perfectly. Listen to the opening of the opera. It has the feel of the opening scene just right. We're at Canterbury in 1170 on a cold, wintry morning. There's a processional feel to the music, like a slow, steady march, as we're reminded that we're inside the cathedral, and the women of Canterbury are about to relate how anxious they are about the return from exile of their beloved Archbishop Thomas. In this music, our composer Pizzetti is acting just like all composers of opera before him, setting the scene, trying to get the right atmosphere for the drama that's to come. His music changes as the drama changes. For instance, when Thomas finally enters the cathedral after his return, we hear this beautiful melody which has a sense of return about it, a sense of homecoming. It becomes a melody attached to the character of Thomas in other parts of the opera to come later. When the four English knights arrive towards the end of the opera, the lords who will kill Thomas, their music is at odds with the music surrounding them. It's very English music. It's jolly and carefree and completely out of sync with the sacred surroundings of the cathedral that the lords find themselves in. Pizzetti even uses music from the period of the story, medieval music, to help tell the story. Music sung in the church at the time of Thomas Becket was called Gregorian chant. It was sung by monks or priests in the choir inside the great churches of this era, including Canterbury. The music sounds sacred. It fits with the environment. Just before Thomas is killed, the chorus on stage sings one of the ancient Gregorian chants that was traditionally sung during the funeral services for someone who has died. Here's the tune. Notice the flowing, kind of winding nature of the melody. The use of this funeral tune is used, of course, to remind us that Thomas himself is about to be assassinated. It's used as a symbol of dread and anxiety, fear about what's to come. Without actually quoting any other Gregorian chant melodies, that same flow, that same winding nature is given by the composer to many other melodies in the opera to give it an overall medieval feel. Even in that opening music that I played for you at the beginning, it has that same chant-like effect. These are just a few of the ways that Pizzetti uses music to tell this tragic tale, a tale from history about a hero who stands up against a tyrant, following his conscience rather than being swayed by the whims of his king. Ildebrando Pizzetti's opera Murder in the Cathedral is a searing portrait of a man struggling with politics and religion, but a man who ultimately knows the right way to turn. The music and the drama of this opera bring this very true story to life, and I think it helps all of us understand ourselves and our relationship to the world just a little bit better. I'm Nick Ravelis, and I'll see you at the opera.